Let's say I have £10,000. What would your advice be for me to...
BSV right now.
What coins?
BSV.
BSV. Well, talk to me about that. What is that? So I can buy the original Bitcoin on your platform.
We built it pretty much for these moments.
The relationship or the connection you had with Gary McKinnon.
Yeah.
Trying to hack NASA.
He did successfully.
So all musicians right now should jump on NFTs like yesterday.
Yeah.
And they'll make more money.
Yeah.
Now?
Now. They're doing it now. They're making more money now. 100% now.
Well, thanks for coming to Link Up and
having
this chat with me. It's interesting because we met a long time ago.
Long time. It's
been
a minute. It's been a minute.
Everyone has one of these stories. Oh, like my boy told me to invest in Bitcoin and they didn't. And I guess that's our story because what was it, 2012 or 2013?
Yeah, it would have been back in 2013, probably.
13, yeah. You were trying to explain to me, you were really excited about Bitcoin and you were saying, you know...
This is before I even set up my company, by the way. So yeah, this is early.
Yeah,
I've done
you,
my company in 2014, so I was talking to you before I even set up my company.
Okay, and the way you were even telling me about Bitcoin was like you knew about it from top to bottom, left to right. So I had recently moved back to the UK, where I came from being the Caribbean. I was trying to acclimatise back into the UK. So to hear this crypto, whatever it was that you were trying to tell me about, I was like, oh, sorry, like whatever you're talking about, leave it over there.
Yeah.
It makes me realise that if you were so passionate about Bitcoin in 2013, and I take it you invested at that time, I was reading recently that if you invested £1,000 into Bitcoin around 2013, you're up £500,000. So what made you invest in Bitcoin when hardly anyone knew what it was about?
So I didn't know it top to bottom, left to right. The one thing I will say, admittedly, I didn't at that point.
Okay.
But I had a
I had
a firm grasp as to where I thought it was and where it can go. What caught my attention was that this was the first time that we have an alternative of an economic system that is void of banks, void of third parties, void of government intervention. So the, I guess, uneducated anarchist in me liked that. The anti-establishment in me liked that. The anti-government in me liked that. And that's what like lit me up about Bitcoin. And I saw it as there's an opportunity here where I can actually set up a new business, being a consultant for private investors and help educate them on this very revolutionary technology that if works at scale, can be very benevolent for humanity, right? So I even had those thought processes really, really, really early on. But it was just a great way where, okay, if this really is what this can be, if we really get it to the point, then this is actually an amazing way to make money.
So before 2015, did you invest more than 2,000 in Bitcoin?
I guess so, yeah.
Okay, and a lot of people, I think they have this battle with crypto and Bitcoin and other coins now, is when do I pull out? Okay, I've made money now, do I hold it there? Or how do you feel about yourself in terms of investing? Did you leave it there for the long haul or did you pull out?
So there's a difference between investing and trading.
Okay. Right?
Now, if you're going to ask me a question as an investor, which is what I identify as, not so much as a trader, I have to look for certain fundamental principles.
Right? What's the, but before you go on, what's the difference in the shortest way possible between a trader and an investor when it comes to cryptocurrency?
When it comes to crypto specifically, it's actually more convoluted because people can't really distinguish between the two. But ultimately is, if you're making a trade, you're looking for increasing your income, right?
Okay.
So you might say, my objective is to make £20,000, £30,000, £50,000 a month. And whatever asset I'm utilizing in order to do that, irrespective. This is my goal, this is my objective. Let's say you're a successful trader and now you've acquired a nice pot of capital, okay? Then you've got to think, okay, what do I do with this capital? I could keep on trading, but if you're a successful trader, you're gonna have surplus, right? And you're never gonna trade 100% of your risk. You never have 100% of your capital in trade. So then you can look at wealth building, right? So then as a wealth builder, you're then going to look for certain fundamental principles, right? Mm-hmm. Why do I think that if I leave my money in this long term, it's going to grow?
Okay.
And
so short-term fix versus long-term fix.
Yeah, you've got the casino, which covers 95%+ of the crypto space. And that is littered with cowboys and gold lace cowboy boots with diamond encrusted sides. And then you've got the people who really understand that there is a potential here for this technology at scale to do something very profound on this planet, and that is actually to make humanity honest. Mm. Now, we need to invest in that infrastructure, but that doesn't really sell headlines.
No, and not just that. It sounds very, you know, heal the world, make it a better. Mm-hmm. But the fact of the matter is, if you get into cryptocurrency, you're doing it to make money, essentially. I understand.
Yes or no.
I understand the bigger picture, or I understand when people. It's funny because when people become really successful or financially stable, that's when they start thinking, I want to heal the world. Mm. But generally speaking, you have to get there to be able to have that mindset.
Absolutely.
But even, and I don't need to be offended by this, but even like me looking at you and when you came in today, how you sound, how you speak, how you dress, someone could easily think that you were, I don't know, from a privileged background, you know, trendy tech, good background in terms of family, financially stable. Mm. But you know, you went through things initially at first, didn't you?
Yeah. I'm glad you had that impression. Thank you. well, that's not the reality. Diamonds built under pressure. And I just don't have a victim mentality.
But then how did you have that mentality? So you grew up near where I grew up, Wood Green, Bounds Green. Yeah, M22. So I know when I grew up there wasn't loads of people around that were on loads of positive things, let alone, you know, tech, fintech, Bitcoin, all the best of it. So you started your first company at 16. Mm-hmm. But at that same time is when your father was incarcerated and went to prison. Are you comfortable in saying why he went to prison?
Drugs. So my dad was a drug dealer. Not a very good one because he's never had money. and he got sent down 11 years.
Right? Okay.
Now, I love my dad. We have a great relationship now. We always had a good relationship, to be fair.
Yeah.
But the best lessons he taught me was through actions to the things, what not to do. Mm-hmm. But also, I was smart enough to kind of dissect the actions and observe them, not just as myself, but just from a wider perspective. And I saw a lot of anger, right? I heard my dad speak on like issues with police and the issues of like being a black man trying to make his way. I heard it, but I didn't resonate with it, even as a kid.
So you didn't, as weird as this may sound, the most important man to you as a teenager, you couldn't relate to him?
Not in his approach, no. It taught me what not to do. So my dad was very like pro me playing ball. I was good, can't lie. I was a good baller. But I wasn't passionate about it.
About professional football?
Yeah, so I used to like go to the trials and stuff. I remember like I went to Charlton trials. I got through all the trials at Charlton. And I remember driving back home, dad's taking me home. And I was like, dad, I don't want to play no more. Like, I was like, I don't want to play no more. He flipped out on me about it, right? But this is how mad it is for me, because I only realized like maybe a month later why he was so angry about it was because Charlton's a professional football club. I didn't even know.
You didn't know. Who sent you to the trials? Your dad?
My dad. But I'm disinterested.
So
this
your
disinterested
dad was quite supportive up until the stage you went to prison?
Yeah, he's very supportive.
With football?
But yeah, football. And then I remember that was very pressurizing. My dad, big, huge, 6'5", black guy, very angry all the time.
Yeah. Right?
So me playing football on the pitch, he's on the sideline screaming and shouting at me, screaming and shouting at me, just zapped all the fun out of it, right? Mm-hmm. And it's very always financially motivated. So I remember going home, driving me home one day, and he's badgering on about, oh, footballers make 100 grand a week. He goes, you could, even a semi-pro, you can make a couple grand a week. And I never will speak back to my dad. I'm like, at this point, I'm like 14.
Yeah. Right?
And for the first time, I was like piped up. I was like, dad, like how many footballers are on the team? He's like, about 22. I was like, they'll make 100 grand a week. He's like, yeah. I was like, okay. So that means that there's a manager writing a check for 2.2 million a week. I want to be that guy.
Right? So you knew from 14?
From a young age.
You wanted to be the manager?
From a young age, not the manager. Yeah. I just wanted to be the businessman.
Okay, so then do you, to, you know, divert quickly, do you think that is an issue in a lot of our communities, that there's so much emphasis placed on you can be the next musician or the next footballer, or many of us are not even listening or seeing what our child could be interested in, mm-hmm. or even good at? Because here you were interested in business from a young age, mm-hmm. That was your thing, but your dad was trying to push you into being a professional footballer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and a lot of that, my interest in business would evolve around my uncle. Like, he had a business, computer business. This is actually where the story ties into Gary McKinnon, if you want to get into that. But my fixation was always tech, breaking things, to be honest with you, because I was always fixated with trying to understand how things work, so I'll piece them back together.
Okay.
And I always had a good idea of what it is that I wanted to do. I don't think I've ever spent any period in my life where I've been at wit's end of what my next move is. Right?
So it doesn't mean I always made the right decision. From 14, 15?
From even younger.
Okay. So then your first business that you set up was at 16?
My first, official business.
Official business. What makes it official?
I had a checkbook with my company name on it.
At 16?
Yeah, I set up deliberately in South Kent as well. Lloyd's Bank in South Kent, just to have South Kent on my checkbook as well.
And what was that business called?
Schick's Computers.
And that was doing?
I was doing something called overclocking. So basically, if the fastest computer in the world, or fastest Intel chip was a 3 gigahertz, I would overclock it and modify it to like over 4 gigahertz by ripping up my refrigeration unit, mm-hmm. bootstrapping it to my PC, cool it to minus 30 degrees, set world records for certain benchmarks, mm-hmm. and people want to send me their stuff so I can do it for them.
Okay, at 16?
At 16. So that's what I started doing at 16.
And then do you feel, because we're similar age, early 30s, mm-hmm. so do you feel that at that age, it was almost embarrassing to be like you? If that makes sense. So a lot of people at that stage would see you as a nerd. You know, all of the girls in school would want the guy that's, you know, playing the football that your dad would want you to do. Mm. And you're here, you know, with a computer business at 16. Mm. Did you ever get bullied or?
Oh, nah.
No, that weren't you, no?
It's nah. nah. I've been very comfortable in my own company. I've never been a circle joiner.
Okay.
I've always just done my own thing. I've never even would quantify or classify myself as a leader, but people have followed me over the years because of my commitment to what it is that I'm doing and the results of what it is that I'm doing produces.
Yeah.
And it's self-belief. And not to say that I don't doubt myself, I'm not my biggest critic.
Yeah.
But I don't request aid from others in order to define what I want to do in life.
So irrespective of what the fashion is, what people rate or like, you are so comfortable with yourself, you know what you want to do, and it doesn't matter what's going on around you.
For the most part.
And right now, someone like you is the fashion to be in fintech, cryptocurrency. So then if we fast forward a bit and talk about the relationship or the connection you had with Gary McKinnon.
Yeah.
Trying to hack NASA.
He did, successfully.
He did?
Biggest military hack in human history. So Gary McKinnon, when Barack Obama took office, one of the first things that he took upon himself was trying to extradite some geezer from the UK, some ginger guy from the UK, called Gary McKinnon, because he just orchestrated the largest military hack in human history. He hacked NASA. Right?
Why did he hack NASA?
He's got Asperger's syndrome. He had a Beaner's bonnet about we're not alone. And he had the skill set to try and get answers.
So he thought that, you know, NASA knows some UFOs out there. I want to see these UFOs. I'm not going to ask them. I'm going to hack the system myself.
Yeah. Now, he was in North London, just Palmer's Green. And he used to buy his computer equipment from my uncle's computer store.
Gary was on ENDS.
He was in ENDS, right, N13. Yeah. And I used to be the Saturday boy there.
Okay.
So I used to see him every now and again. And then when this all broke out, I was hacking and doing some like stuff myself, nothing to that degree.
I knew it.
At all.
I knew you've had an element of hacking in you.
So I was working on something. I was like, fuck, like, I've got a great opportunity to ask this guy.
Yeah, like, the king of all hackers.
Yeah. I was like, dude, I need to talk to you, right? So I was talking to him. This is literally back at now my mum's house.
Yeah.
Right? I'm having this conversation with Gary. I just got to the opportunity to ask him questions, like two major ones, which is what, one, dude, why the fuck did you hack NASA? And secondly, like, why do you do it from your house? Right, that's just basic ops.
That's the
like,
dumbest thing ever.
That, right? But So he told me that his whole fixation with proving that we're not alone. Long story short, he told me he saw pre and post Photoshop images of the moon. So the Photoshop images.
He saw Photoshop images of the moon.
Pre and post Photoshop images of the moon.
So it was a lie when they landed on the moon.
We're digressing here.
I was not supposed to ask that.
Okay, so I believe that to be true, right?
What, that it was a lie?
No, yes. We landed on the moon, but also it was manufactured as well. Both stories are true.
But they didn't want to show the real one.
It. Yes, and there's reason for that.
Okay, we won't get too deep into that, but that sounds mad interesting. Yeah.
So he told me sort of pre and post Photoshop images on the moon. Photoshop images are basically Google the moon. It's pretty much what you see. The pre Photoshop images, broken domes, obliques, and a crash craft. And also Tommy saw a file called off-planet operatives, so human
beings. Did he see aliens? He did all this, I want to know. He doesn't believe we're here alone. Did he see an alien?
No.
Oh. So that was pretty pointless.
Well, it depends, man. No? I mean, the obliques and a dome on the moon and the crash craft on the moon, I find pretty freaking interesting.
For people like me, what is an obliques?
Outside the White House, right?
Yeah.
No, Pentagon. You got the... obliques, the big phallus.
And there's one on the moon?
Yes.
Okay.
And a broken dome. And more interestingly, a file indicating a list of human beings who work off-planet, like off-planet operatives, so human beings who work off-planet. So my whole thing is like, that was very much...
So hang on. We've got to draw this back here. Mm-hmm. Humans that work off-planet, meaning they do not work on Earth.
Yeah.
Where do they work?
Just not on Earth.
Okay, that's as good as an alien. Seeing as you rubbed shoulders with one of the biggest hacker, I'm not saying you do, but would it be very easy for you to hack Bitcoin?
Oh, no one, no, no.
No?
Nah. You can hack an individual.
Are you just saying that you because
No, because right now there's $1.3 trillion worth of value there, and the reason why it's there is because it's proven to be unhackable over the last 12 years. It's the most secure... network on the planet.
So then, if that's the case, how come there are people that have still managed to get hacked or lose their Bitcoin?
Because that's on an individual basis, right? So you yourself can be hacked for a variety of different ways and a variety of different angles.
Yes, I'm asking, right? If you wanted to, could you hack my Bitcoin?
No.
But you just said that...
It's just a simple answer to that question. Otherwise, we're going to be talking about hacking for like the next 20 minutes.
Fair enough.
But no.
Okay, fair enough. So I'm going to ask questions, whether it's in football terms or to a 10-year-old. If you had to explain to a 10-year-old, because as you said, there's loads of people that understand Bitcoin now. It's not a new phenomenon. People are investing, they're making money.
I would argue hardly anyone understands Bitcoin.
Okay, so this is the point that I'm getting at. So with the majority of people in the world, we don't understand Bitcoin. So if you had to explain to a 10-year-old, what is Bitcoin? How would you explain it?
Simple, paper and pen. So Bitcoin took one of the oldest technologies we've ever invented, a piece of paper, it digitized it, and it made it public. That's the amazing innovation of Bitcoin. Ironically, it's not a cryptocurrency. To be a crypto means there's some form of blinding. It's all public. So why is that important? Why is that cool? It resolves one of the key fundamental issues in contract law. If you know how to engage, you mentioned about a property deal, right?
Yeah.
If you know how to engage in a property deal, right, we can sign a contract right now because we've got three choices of a witness. Mm-hmm. Right? The reason why a witness is required on the contract, because if there's a dispute and we need to follow the adjudication process, right, we can bring a witness to stand, right? Say, okay, this is what happened, this is what I heard, yada, yada. Now, when you make the piece of paper public, then the whole world is the witness. So now I can automate my contracts.
So you're saying because it's not regulated or it's not centralized?
No, forget regulation, forget centralized. All I'm saying is this is a piece of paper that the whole world can read and the whole world can pick up the pen to write.
So give me in real times. So I want to go and buy some Bitcoin. How does that fit into what you're saying in terms of what Bitcoin is?
Why would you want to buy Bitcoin in the first place if you don't understand what it is, right? So,
well, people are and they're making money.
The Bitcoin that people are running around for isn't the paper. They don't understand the paper. They're not interested in understanding the paper. All they care about is the pen because the paper is not useful without a pen.
Right? Okay.
So now in the world of crypto right now, the most coveted pen is a BTC Bitcoin. That is $66,000 right now. That is a diamond encrusted Cartier pen. Okay.
Okay.
Now, if I give you that pen, you can floss, you can boast that you've got one of these pens or you've got a couple of these pens.
Yeah.
But if I now say to you, Lin, okay, go back to the piece of paper, mm-hmm. right, 'cause that's the network, draw me a Mona Lisa. That pen, the ink is so clumped up that you can only do 3 to 4 strikes on that paper per second. And each strike on that piece of paper right now on average costs you $10 to $20 in fees. Mm-hmm. By the time you've even got to drawing me a Mr. Men, you're about $1,000 in fees.
So tell me that in tangible day-to-day activity of what that actually means. So you're saying that people are buying Bitcoin.
And it's a broken pen.
They don't know why they're buying it. So what are the negative repercussions from how you just explained this broken pen is?
It means that everyone's out running buying a pen because Elon Musk tweeted about it. That's going to be the payment network of the planet. But if I said it only does 3 to 4 transactions a second, what that means is it's 350,000 in a day. There's 7.5 billion people on the planet. So not everyone on the planet, Africa, South America, India, has the chance to pick up a pen and have a shot at Mona Lisa.
So
why are people paying 66 grand for it?
So you're sounding quite negative towards Bitcoin at the moment.
I told you, I'm not like the normal crypto guys.
So if I was to shorten and simplify what you've just said, is that there's no actual intrinsic value to Bitcoin, and the only thing that makes it valuable is due to people like Elon Musk saying it's amazing, run out and buy some, and then the value increases. But there's actual no value in it, or it's not useful until everyone in the world can access it. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, it's been Trojan horsed. It's been corrupted. It's been changed. This is BTC, the one at $66,000. They've created a narrative that is all anti-bank, anti-government, is digital gold, HODL. Don't use HODL.
What's HODL?
It means it encourages you not to use your Bitcoin. That means that it limits the queue to use it, right? So.
And does that increase the value then?
Because
it's limiting.
You're limited in liquidity.
Yes.
Right? And the belief system is it's always going to go up.
Yeah.
Right? So the irony is, majority of the space is being culled by the same banks and bad interests that they think they're opposing.
Okay.
Because it's those same interests that stepped in. MasterCard bought into a company called Digital Currency Group.
Yeah.
Digital Currency Group bought all the major exchanges. They bought all the major news outlets to then enforce and solidify this bullshit narrative.
So you think Bitcoin's only going to be good once we really all understand it?
No, Bitcoin's going to be good when no one needs to understand it. When entrepreneurs build businesses that make it so seamless, you don't need to know about the plumbing. People in the crypto space want to say, use Bitcoin, use Ethereum, use Solana. To me, what they sound like is use Mario, use Luigi, use Wario. All cryptos are just plumbing systems. Like any good plumbing system, for instance, this establishment right now, if you switch on that tap, you just expect it to work. I'm not going to have a conversation with you about the size and dimension of the pipes. But that's what people are doing in the world of crypto.
Yeah, okay. Sounds very technical. You've been studying, you know, physics and maths since you were 16. Mm-hmm. I get it. My point is, you can't tell that to a group of people now who's earning, irrespective of whether it's, you know, an inflated value of £66,000. People are still making money from it.
That's great. But understand what's going on.
Why?
We go back to earlier on in your questioning. You said trading, investing.
No, because you're contradicting yourself. You're saying we need to understand it. Mm. But like you said, if I go to a tap and turn it on, I don't understand the plumbing. I don't understand what connects what. I just want the water. So for people that are investing in Bitcoin and crypto, as long as they can make money from it, why do they need to understand the rudiments of it?
Yeah, if you're using something, you don't need to know. If you're investing in something or trading or speculating on something, it's on your best interest.
Yeah, okay. Right?
And that's on the individual, right? So make money from Bitcoin. I've made money from Bitcoin. I became a millionaire from Bitcoin, right? From alts as well. But the technology, the real technology that can actually make humanity honest if we implement it correctly, that's what I'm advocating for. That's the real Bitcoin.
I get you. So let's bring it back and talk about people who are very new to the game. Mm. Yeah. Is there going to be another coin that's going to mirror Bitcoin where if I put in 1,000 now, in 10 years, I can also be a millionaire?
Well, people are making more money than that in NFTs right now. So you got a better shot of doing that in NFTs. There's loads of examples of doing that in NFTs right now.
So you'd advise someone, if you're a beginner to crypto,
NFTs,
go to NFTs straight away.
Yeah.
Can you explain to me what an NFT is?
So it is a Bitcoin, there are 21 million of them, right? And they're all interchangeable for other Bitcoins.
So what does that mean?
It means they're fungible. It means if I take a £10 note out, you'll swap it for your £10 note and not feel any way about it because they're both £10 notes.
Okay, right? So what was the point in that?
With NFT, it's unique, right? It's genuinely unique. It's a digital asset that is genuinely unique. So when we have that, we now enter a world where creative can actually have rarity, right? You can validate scarcity and rarity in your work. So if you think about a clothing label, loads of clothing lines do drops, right? You're just speaking about Trapstar moments ago. They do drops, or it will greatly benefit them and get around their counterfeiting issues if they just apply an NFT tag to their clothing. And now I can genuinely validate it's a 1 of 25, 1 of 100. Ownership and proof of ownership influences value.
But what's the difference between the tag of an NFT to validate that item of clothing versus the tags that labels put in the collar anyway? What would be the difference? Because what I realize about the world and how life goes is no matter what you create, it can always be replicated to a degree. So that's why people, you know, counterfeit notes, then technology, even in the criminal world, advances. Mm-hmm. So how would you prevent that?
Large parts, you can't prevent a lot of it on the first instance, in a sense of if you go to an art gallery, you take a photo of a Mona Lisa or Monet, does it decrease or increase the value of that painting? You could argue it increases the value because you get more exposure. NFTs is kind of a little bit different in the sense I can actually download that JPEG with the way most people are executing it, and I can basically have the same thing on my wallpaper, on my phone, etc. But that doesn't mean that I own it. Mm-hmm. Right? Now, the world that we're entering is you own a digital asset and you could actually lease its use to other individuals. You can...
Give me an example, like a day-to-day example.
A day-to-day example would be, say, for instance, the $69 million people, right? People are like, why would anyone pay that much money for an NFT? I think that's pretty crazy, not gonna lie. But the use case for the buyer, I said what he said he's gonna utilize it for, is he's gonna use it in the metaverse, right? So imagine being in a digital world and this art is on display, and it only be on display to be experienced in a more, say, interactive dimensionality in this setting. What NFTs does, it opens up the door to enable everyone to turn everything ultimately into Pokemon Go. So an example of that would be, let's say you've got an artist, I don't know, M. Hunter, right? Mm-hmm. He's got a show on in London, and for his fans who go to that physical show, you'll be given a custom NFT album art for his latest album that's unique specifically for people who went to that show. So he can use it as a gamification tactic. But also, M. Hunter is not just going to do a show in London, he might do one in Birmingham, might do one in Manchester, might do one in Glasgow, where each different location you've got now a limited album cover. So now it's providing a collectible aspect. The whole Pokemon Go, the Pokemon cards, even things like back in the day with like Pogs.
So it's all virtual reality?
It's virtual, but also you could do physical. So again, going back to say the Trapstar example, you could do physical clothing as an NFT, but then I can click an option and have that same clothing item on my digital representation. So this is where we get into the world now of digital avatars, which fortunately, for my explanations, Mark Zuckerberg just introduced his plans with Facebook and Meta, where you see he's got his digital twin in front of him in that preview. So this is where brands 100% are going to be going. We're going to have a very seamless blend between what is real and then have a digital overlay.
So what you're saying essentially with the NFTs and the metaverse is if I want to buy a Dior coat physically, there'll be an option to buy a virtual Dior coat, and I'll do that via an NFT. Is that what it is?
Yeah, it's just like the new social
And I'll only wear it online, and you'll see me online wearing this Dior coat, but then maybe I don't have a physical one, I just have the one online.
No. So at the beginning, yes.
Yeah.
Where it's eventually going is, I can perceive that you're wearing that coat right now. Because if my glasses are also tapped into this technology and you have depicted yourself as such, it could render live.
How many years are we talking here? Because this is sounding very... 5 years, this is going to be the norm.
I wouldn't say the norm, but I reckon it's going to be there. It's to be a possibility in five. Funny enough, I reckon within 10 years, if you see a girl's ass that you think is amazing, you'll be able to scan it with your glasses and download it on yours so that other people, when they're looking at you, think that's yours. I don't like the sound of these things, right? And I think it's a
thing. Is there some sort of harassment, privacy issue here?
Hey, listen, that's just a crazy
Someone's
thing.
Someone's going to walk around with my ass? Possible.
Right. Well, if you so there you go, then you think, okay, well, how can it work for me? You can actually.
I can charge them.
Exactly.
Okay. So going back to what I asked you before.
Everyone that downloads it, you're getting a royalty.
Scene. So that's why people are connecting NFTs with like memes.
With everything, it's like it's limited based on human imagination. As long as the cost of creation is low and reliably low,
yeah.
Then human beings can create. This is a place of creation. You guys are all creatives, right? Now, if you have a means and a way of being able to cut out middlemen and be able to gamify your communities to get more value for your creation, that is what's creating the NFT buzz.
Okay, so let's go back to my initial question. I just want to make some money, do you know what I mean? I want to make some money, and you've suggested to me, I don't know anything about anything,
uh-huh.
And you've said, Lin, don't do crypto, do NFT. What is your 4 steps of advice for me to make some money within 4 weeks via this NFT? What do I do next? I need money now.
Themes. Themes are really important. Get into the culture. The culture is quite unique in crypto. For instance, aped is like the latest term now in the crypto scene. So if you're going aggressive on an investment, you've gone aped. On investment, it's very clicky as culture, but then aped-based NFTs are doing very well, right? So understand the culture and what's like the latest, say, meme-related term or like the cool term, and stories are important, right? So if you're just gonna come in and do one-off NFT, unless you're Beeple, are you really gonna pull that off? And even Beeple, he done an image every single day. Can't remember exactly how long he done it for. To build up the story to then get to that point where he could justify commanding such a high value. Stories are important. Understanding the culture and what's current and what's new. And pick your platform wise. So a lot of the platforms actually kind of require upfront investment. So this is where the fees, so the different plumbing systems, the choice of the different plumbing systems mm-hmm. affect the end user. So if you're on like OpenSea, typical minting fee to create an NFT is like $60, $100. So you need upfront investment.
So how much is it to create an NFT?
About $60 to $100 on most platforms, even like a couple hundred
dollars. And how
would I
create
platforms.
It? What am I creating? Give me an example.
Just imagine just uploading a JPEG, right? You're clicking a few buttons, you're stipulating your royalties. So in future sales, I want 10% of proceeds of future sales. And you click create, this is on a good platform. You click create,
yeah.
And then you've created your NFT. It's
so,
really simple.
So if I want to create a meme tonight, before I release it onto Instagram, I'm going to go onto an NFT platform. I'm going to pay $60 to $100.
Only up until now, on my platform, it will be $1.
Okay, even better. I'm coming to your platform. I'm like, do you know what? I've got this great meme. I'm ready to post it on Instagram tomorrow, but I want to make sure every time someone shares it, I make money. Is that how
not
you
time,
do it?
Not time every time someone shares it. Is if you've done a run of like, say, 10 or 1,000, even just the one, if you sold it, someone owns it, and then it sells for 2,000, then you can get 10% of the additional.
So only if I sell 1,000. The meme?
Yeah, only if you sell it, and then other people are trading it and buying and selling it.
I'm not convinced I'm going to make money in 4 weeks of this. Can we go back to crypto? No, only because it's like such a new phenomenon.
You know what? I think you're probably noticing. You're not going to box me into this time frame thing, right?
For me, like my whole... Do you think that's a big issue, that we're too eager to make money now?
Yes. like,
were you really patient with when you became a millionaire?
Like, I have a tortoise approach, not the fucking hare. And to a degree, like, some way to my detriment in crypto, I would be a lot more liquid, a lot more far ahead if I did take certain short-term decisions. But it would have completely screwed my long-term vision and long-term goals.
Okay.
There are certain things that people just don't understand. If you're trying to build a business, that's what I definitely recommend. Like, this is now the age and era where you should entrepreneurs should be thinking about what new business ventures can I do because this technology exists, if they pick their platform correctly.
Okay.
But for the quick buck stuff, there's a whole bunch of like YouTubers out there who are going to sell you a bunch of false information. As long as you get onto that false information at the right time, you can make money, right?
Okay, yeah. Would you say, because I think there's a lot of concern around crypto at the moment with regards to liking it to gambling. Essentially, is that what you think it is? Where, like you said, there's not a lot of intrinsic value to these coins, but because everyone, if they see a tweet by Elon, they run and buy it, that increases the value.
And just get synced into that culture. And it is easy to make money in crypto, but you have to get synced into that culture.
Seeing all of the graphs and the patterns every day?
Understanding the culture in a sense of it's very meme related. It's not fundamental driven. It's not driven by typical market forces. It's driven a lot of hype. It's driven a lot of whales, right? So key individuals who manipulate where an asset's going. You've got to understand these cultural impacts around crypto. So for instance, right now the hot things in terms of crypto are Doge and Shiba, right? These are just...
Do you think they're going to be as valuable as Bitcoin in 10 years?
No, because there's nothing to them apart from the fact that they're memes, right? And then you've got, when you say a 10-year time frame...
So what's the difference between Doge and Bitcoin?
First and foremost, Bitcoin is a commodity, right? And the way that Bitcoin was created is for it to be legally and lawfully compliant. None of these other coins are designed as such. The way that they came into creation, arguably most of them are securities. So when you talk about...
Like XRP.
So when you talk about a 10-year time frame, the space is going to be completely different, right? The regulators are eventually going to catch up. We hit $3 trillion when the dot-com boom went kaput. Before the regulators got to catch up to it, they were at $20 trillion. They were far bigger than crypto. Right? We're not even close to being called a real big market that can just, we can very easily disappear and get reformatted. Mm. And I actually think that could happen by the end of this month, by the way, because you've got the biggest court case in the history of crypto over Satoshi Nakamoto's estate, which is $315 billion being contested, 1.1 million of which is coins, which is $70 billion. And that case can monumentally have
set a precedent.
Huge precedent. Mm. So this is why I have to give you the message that these fundamental things are important.
And what do you reckon that precedent will be? Do you think that as much as it's not regulated, crypto is not regulated now, and that's why a lot of people use it, people use it on, you know, the black market, so on and so forth. Do you think there's going to be a time where the government says no? Like, this is getting out of hand. We like the fact that we can control things from the central bank. We need to crack down on this.
Yeah, absolutely. They have the ability to crack down on it really easily. To shut
Why
down.
Do you think they haven't so far then?
That's a good question. For the most part, it serves their agenda really well.
How?
Well, if you've got a low friction way of moving money around the world, and even though it's not truly anonymous, but you control the fiat on-ramps and off-ramps, it can be a very efficient mechanism of moving money around, doing illicit trade, trafficking, arms deals. It can be a very good mechanism.
So the government's probably in on the...
Yeah, well, why is the market underpinned by an asset that hasn't been audited? So the largest volumes traded daily is Tether, which is a stable coin. It's meant to be one-to-one backed with dollars in a bank vault. It's not been audited, but it's got $70 billion worth of value and it has in excess of $50 billion being traded.
So you think they're doing it on purpose, they're not regulating it on purpose. So let's move on to like your current business ventures. So have you got a platform that could be likened to Coinbase?
Yeah.
So this is quite strange then, because I'm saying to you, you know, what's the next best coin to invest in? Or if I leave here, tonight, what coins would you suggest that I purchase? And the reason why I say that's quite strange that you're being a little hesitant with telling me is because you actually have a platform where you could encourage me to sign up and then start trading on your platform.
But it's just never been my narrative. So
why have you created it then? If you are saying there's no value in these coins, you know, Bitcoin makes sense.
I said there's no value. I said you can make a lot of money. But you have to know fundamentally what these are really all about. So then where do you put the money that you've then actually made and actually make some real investments and then you can have some real game-changing money?
So do you provide advice on your platform?
No, don't provide on my platform. So Gravity is being built in a modular way. So right now we are the best place to buy and sell Bitcoin, predominantly Bitcoin SV, which is a real Bitcoin. Whenever I talk positively about Bitcoin, I'm really talking about Bitcoin SV.
What's the difference?
That's the one that came out with the original white paper back in 2009. The one at $66,000 massively veered off task with what Satoshi, the original inventor, wanted from the project and is working on with the project.
So which one
this
made
is
you...
Rogue.
Which
this
one
is the
made,
fake one at 66 grand.
Which one
I'm
made
saying.
You a millionaire?
Ironically, this one.
The fake one?
Yes, the fake
so
one.
So you can't be so negative towards something that made you a millionaire.
At one point, these two arms were joined as one.
Okay. Right?
Then things splintered off.
When did they split?
So 2016 is when all things started to fall apart. And then there was quite a few splits by end of 2018.
If I go onto your platform today, can I use it instead of Binance or Coinbase?
Yes, you can buy or sell a variety of different assets.
Can I buy more coins than I can on Coinbase? Because no. People don't really, I can't.
No, there's more coins on Coinbase.
There's more coins right on Coinbase. Yeah. Is that because you're new and you're hoping to eventually get there?
We will never overbloat the platform with a lot of these coins. We are going to be building we are getting a platform ready for the next wave of what crypto is going to become. When the regulators are stepping in and where a lot of projects and coins are being built on this version of Bitcoin, which is what's happening now.
So do you think everyone now that is trading with Bitcoin or cryptocurrency, all these different like Doge, are we going to get to a point where it's going to be regulated and people are going to lose a lot of their money because governments are going to step in or, like you said, regulators are going to step in and say, hang on a minute, no, we don't like this coin, how it's moving, that coin doesn't have any value, this doesn't say what it
happening.
Says, and they're going to move
Binance as a company is being chased out of vast majority of jurisdictions.
So what if I have 20,000 in all of these coins, I could lose that tomorrow once the regulators step in?
Yeah, I mean, as quickly, as easy as it goes up, things will crash. But the whole regulation thing's been coming for years.
Yeah.
I still reckon it's going to take at least a couple of years.
So people have got a couple of years to really keep flipping with these coins that
I think over the next
no
2
value.
Years, it's going to be progressively changing in terms of the perspective of what people see this space as, how the technology works from a legal precedent. For instance, right now in the world of crypto, is if you have the keys, they're yours, right? So in the world of crypto, it's like, if you were silly enough to leave your car key, right, when you leave this building, and I pick up your key, it's my car. That's crypto, right?
Yeah.
And then the onus is on you for being silly enough to lose your car key. Right?
Yeah, and that's not fair legally.
It's not.
That's going to change.
Yeah, but in the real world, if that happened, you shouldn't stress out too much because as long as that car's registered in your name on the DVLA database and insured, you call the police and say, can you go redeem my property for me?
Mm-hmm.
Regulation isn't a bad thing. Regulation is put there to prevent human beings, myself, but then when they get in positions of power, myself.
But you're anti-government.
To not,
so how can you be
to
anti-government?
To not abuse that power.
How can you be like anti-government?
It's a maturity, Lin.
Oh, so you're saying you used to be.
I am. I'm not anti-government. I'm anti-big government. I'm anti-government overreach. There's no historical
too much power.
Evidence of when we've governments overreached and given it back. I'm very pro-small government. But also, I'm realistic, right? I can't change the world. I can at least try and be the change I want to see in the world. And that's the take and the approach that I take. But we have to change it from within. Yeah. And the only way you can do that is out-compete and build great shit. Like, there's two different approaches to, say, metaverse. What Mark Zuckerberg's doing is going to enslave humanity, right?
Really? I thought you was all for this.
Again,
the metaverse.
Not black and white. Lin. It's like, if, just because a
That's
guy...
That's a very loaded statement, enslave humanity.
Yes, just because he's done a rebrand, why is everyone forgetting that this guy has done the most onerous things with our data, right? He's not a good person to be giving our data to, clearly, right? So now we're going to give him the one thing that's true unique about us in this universe. You and I are sharing a space right now, but you and I have very unique perspectives of this space. That's what's unique to every human being. Mm-hmm. We can share a space, but you are seeing what you're seeing, and I'm seeing what I'm seeing. We're the only ones in the freaking universe doing that. In Zuckerberg's world, as soon as you put on the glasses, hooked up to his server, we lose that.
But I don't understand this privacy thing, because people keep on talking about we're concerned about privacy when we look at the metaverse and what it could become. But it's exactly that. It's not a real world. So if you and I meet...
And I sound like Morpheus now. Define real.
No,
what is real?
If we meet in this metaverse or a room in the metaverse, how can we be scared about privacy when it's not real?
No, it is. That's the thing. It's not, and it is. It becomes real when everything that you've experienced, when you entered in and came out of, is being recorded. It is very real.
Every intimate moment you have,
whether it's with the digital shit on, or like it's, you haven't flicked it on, but yet you're still wearing the glasses and it's tapped into his servers, is real. The angle that cryptocurrency space has is we have an ability to incentivize through economics, right? And that's a great, reliable way of incentivizing human beings. Mm-hmm. In order for that to be the lubricant that we want at scale, we have to incentivize in small denominations. So you have to be able to do micropayments, right? So this could be, say, a concert you live stream and the people who are watching it are paying by the second, right? That's an empowering thing for a creative.
Is it going to be more expensive? Like if I just pay, I don't know, 70 quid to go and see an artist, do you think paying by the second is going to be more expensive in this new way of like NFTs?
No, I think it's going to be more efficient for everyone, and the artist is going to earn an exceptional amount of more money because you're communicating directly with your audience. You're selling your talent directly to your audience.
So things like Live Nation are going to completely be a thing of the past.
I think the good labels, agencies are already thinking ahead, and they're already having the conversations around their place in NFTs, and I think they've got a great place.
Labels.
They got the game changing.
But labels have got a bad habit of being quite selfish when it comes to their artists or controlling the narrative.
Labels who do not adapt are going to die real quick.
So, no, I mean, in general, are we going to get to a place where an artist, you said peer-to-peer, right? And it's more beneficial because it's directly to their audience.
Everyone's going to do Tory Lane stuff.
So can, essentially, artists be more direct and not need labels or not need... I mean, we're going to get to a place where no labels are needed.
Exactly, no.
Okay.
Very much.
And that's through NFTs.
It's because of NFTs. You can just sell directly to your audience.
So all musicians right now should jump on NFTs like yesterday.
Yeah.
And they'll make more money.
Yeah.
Now?
Now. They're doing it now. They're making more money now. 100% now.
And you're essentially cutting out the middleman, the label.
If you're independent, yeah, you could just do that right now. So artists who are independent, like thank your lucky stars and pat yourself on the back that you've gone down that route, because now's the time it's going to massively pay dividends because you've got to create a free rein to jump straight into the NFT space and not worry about trying to get out onerous contracts.
Okay.
So it's really empowering. I'm seeing that firsthand with like meetings that I'm having and stuff.
Yeah.
It's really empowering.
Would you, because you seem to know so much about this, would you be willing to give advice to maybe artists or people out there?
I'm doing that at the moment. Yeah, we're launching our NFT exchange Q1. So we're having a lot of conversations now around the curation. So there's a lot of people that we're speaking with, some household names even, around just the process of that. And the buzz when people realize that this is all about empowering them, right, is very, very, very real. Like it's electric at the moment because we are in that era where people could just be empowered by tech. And the creators have always had a really bad deal.
Creatives.
And this is their time. And it's freaking awesome to witness, to be quite frank.
No, that's good. That's good, because I think people don't know how to start or where to start from, or don't even know this information out there. And the conventional of, you know, get a label or, you know, other ways of how they would usually make money, and this new route is going to allow them to make lots more money.
Yeah.
But as I was saying before we wrap up, I try to add value, and by doing that with people that I sit down and talk to, I request that they allow for a shadowing opportunity. Is that something that you're willing to do?
I'm down.
Okay, so what would be the process in terms of the screening process if you are happy to take on a mentee or someone to shadow you?
Someone who's got a genuine interest for crypto and NFTs.
Okay, and for me personally, because I know you've danced around it a bit, let's say I have £10,000. Cool. What would your advice be for me to...
BSV right now.
What coins?
BSV.
BSV. Bitcoin. Well, talk to me about that. What is that?
So Bitcoin SV is the original Bitcoin as per the original design of Satoshi Nakamoto. Satoshi Nakamoto still works on it today. Yeah. Satoshi Nakamoto is in court right now validating and proving that he is Satoshi Nakamoto. Right now it is, I believe, $180 last time I checked. If I'm not mistaken, that is 370 times cheaper than a fake one, which is $66,000.
So you think if you're saying, and this obviously is an estimate, if I buy one of these for the original Bitcoin for $160,
$180,
how much possibly do you think if you had to guess?
I'm gonna tell you a real story, a real, real story.
Can you tell me how much I could make in maybe 2 months or a year or 4 years?
All right, I'm gonna tell you this real story and you can take from it what you want.
Okay, go
on. So one of my first big clients was a surgeon. She done £1 million investment.
Yeah.
5,500 coins she got. So when Bitcoin is like $300.
Yeah.
I told her it would be worth 50K within the next 7 years. I got a presentation still in my Google Drive, right? I had predictions as to like where it's going and why it's going in this direction. But I believe her holdings today would be in excess of, I think, 380 million. And
from taking your advice?
Yeah, I'm more confident today about Bitcoin SV at $180 than I was when I was telling her, knocking on doors 7 years ago when Bitcoin's $300 to put $1 million in.
Mate, I'm buying some of that tonight.
Well, I will say though, there is a really great coverage of the court case. It's on CoinGeek YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. It's by a guy called Kurt Wookert. Mm-hmm. He's been doing daily updates because he's in the court every single day on that court case. That court case will be concluded by Thanksgiving, which I think in the US is a couple of weeks. And this is over 1.1 million BTC, so $70 billion. If Craig Wright, who is Satoshi Nakamoto, I've come out publicly and said, this guy Satoshi Nakamoto from years ago, got multiple interviews with him on my YouTube channel, 100% this guy Satoshi Nakamoto. 100%. He's based in London. He's an Aussie. Bit of an asshole, to be honest, but I love him.
Yeah.
If he loses, there's no scenario where he's not Satoshi. He's being sued, not because he's not Satoshi. If he wasn't Satoshi, they're not trying to get $70 billion out of him.
Okay.
Right? So if he loses, he has to transfer coins to the opposing side.
Okay.
If he wins, he's also said he's going to transfer coins. Now, when he moves these coins, this is the one thing that the whole space for the last 5 years has been bastardizing, chastising, and calling him a fraud over. Mm. It would nullify their argument. That then, I'm gonna give you another nugget now, could set real legal issues for Coinbase. So Coinbase is a public listed company, right? They're worth over 20 billion, I think it is now. Mm-hmm. And when you do a public listing, you have to stipulate seismic risk to your model. Mm-hmm. Right? So on their perspective, they mentioned that if the identity of Satoshi Nakamoto was to be revealed, it'll be a cataclysmic event for them, right? In 2 weeks, it's gonna be freaking pretty much validated. And they have not come out and set a public statement that this case is going on because they're entwined with the deep state and they're trying to make people not realize that this is really going on, even to potentially their own detriment.
So this could increase the coin that you just advised, the original Bitcoin. This, once this concludes, this court case...
It could pop.
It could increase the value of what I'm going to buy tonight.
If you do, Gravity. Best place to buy and sell Bitcoin SV. There you
Gravity, go. Which there is you your go. Platform. Yeah, so I can buy the original Bitcoin on your platform?
We built it pretty much for these moments.
And is it fair, like I said, I know people that know about crypto can really understand everything that you're saying and most things, well, they think they can. But for someone who's new to it, using your platform, is it fairly seamless, easy?
Yeah, we've done it so it's just really easy. Yeah. It's really easy to get money on, really easy to buy, really easy to get money off.
Converting?
Yeah, yeah. Our whole approach is to just demystify the space and just make it simple. I build it because I want my mum to use it. Like that's that okay. kind of bench.
That's attractive to me.
Yeah, it's like mums need to be able to use it.
Yeah, because I'm not good with the tech stuff. I'll keep it 100. But before we wrap up, the way how you talk, the things that you're interested in, how far you've become, millionaire from Bitcoin, is any of that because
of... I was doing very well before Bitcoin, by the way.
Oh, you was a millionaire before Bitcoin?
I was doing very well before Bitcoin.
Okay, from what?
I was like earning 7-8 grand a month when I was 18 in college.
What was this from?
We didn't have enough time for that, Lin. Maybe next time.
Can you just tell me quickly what it's from?
It's tech again. It's always tech.
Computers?
Yeah, the shit's computer stuff. I didn't stop it at
16. Oh, your business,
going.
Of course.
I built it up.
Okay, so would you, I don't want to say thank, but would you attribute it to living in China? Because you set up a business in China.
Yeah, so I was like 19, Shenzhen. That was an interesting period. That I learned a lot about business. And culture, to be fair.
Chinese culture is completely different, isn't it?
To be honest, I attribute most of my success to that conversation with Gary McKinnon.
Oh, really? The hacker, the NASA hacker?
In terms of setting my my framework for then what I then went and aggressively studied, that's been the most impactful thing. It just set me on a course of getting the answers to questions that most people actually are even scared of asking, let alone trying to go and get the answers for. Mm. Like, how does the world work, really?
Yeah.
Once you understand these things, you get to see the play, and then you can navigate your way around what you know the playbook is.
And you're literally living proof of, you know, growing up where I grew up, father went to prison, you also was bankrupt by 21, was it? Mm. And a lot of people with that would have said, oh, you know what, fuck this, like, I've given up. But you're very successful now, again, became a millionaire, and the knowledge is above everything I just mentioned. Mm. So that is living proof that no matter what you go through, you can still be here and a success.
Oh, 100.
So thank you for coming.
Thank you. And it's been awesome. We shouldn't leave it 10 years when we have conversations.
No. It won't be next time.
Cool.